today I'm talking about police militarization, but also the war on drugs, because I think one has fed into the other. The title of my talk has to do with economics, and there are certain economic factors that have played into the transformation that we've seen in your typical local police into the paramilitary outfit we observe today. First point I want to make is the great point that Mises himself made in 1920 in his great essay, Economic Calculation and the Socialist Commonwealth. And there he identified the fundamental problem at the heart of traditional socialism, not Sweden-style socialism, real socialism where private ownership of the means of production is forbidden. The point that he identified is that the Socialist Planning Board does not have access to prices for the means of production. And if you don't have access to prices of your inputs, then you can't calculate profit and loss. There's no arithmetical way to determine whether you're doing well or badly when there's no input cost to subtract from your sales revenues. So you're completely in the dark in your allocation of resources. And when allocating resources for an entire economy, you're making decisions that involve, well, millions of products, let's say, which could be made in 8 gazillion possible ways. Think of all the possible inputs that could go into all the possible goods, all the production processes that could be employed to produce this tremendous array of goods. And you can imagine there are many different possible combinations, almost all of which would be ludicrously uneconomic. And so what the market does through prices is to push entrepreneurs through profit and loss to engage in that combination of productive resources that is the least wasteful in terms of foregone opportunities, to make sure that all the scarce capital goods we have and inputs that we have are arrayed in a configuration in which the goods that consumers demand are produced in such a way that goods that they demand more urgently are not sacrificed in the interest of producing goods they demand less urgently. That input, if lumber is more urgently needed in this production process, then this production process has the ability, because there are multiple owners in a free market economy, to bid those resources away from production processes that could get away with a process that uses less lumber. And all these possible factors of where should I build my physical plant? Should I build right next to where my sales are going to be? Or should I build over here where the land prices are lower but my transportation costs will be higher? And then how should I produce and in what quantities? The Socialist Planning Board is completely in the dark when answering these questions. Now, a government like the United States, on the other hand, is not a socialist government in the sense that Mises meant, because we do have private ownership of the means of production. But when government spends, it is always in a kind of calculational darkness, because although it does have prices of inputs, it doesn't have any legitimate sales revenues. Government acquires its revenues through force, through violence, or through threats of violence. Somebody once said, just think of it this way, if you get a telephone call from the IRS or from Apple Computer, which one are you more frightened of, right? Now, what results from this that's relevant for us today is that there is no profit and loss feedback mechanism in the case of security services that are provided by the government. So how do they know what to provide, what types of services to provide? Let's give them the benefit of the doubt that they wanted to provide us with something good. Even if they wanted to, it'd be hard for them to know, should they have 8,000 judges or 25 judges? What should the police be doing? What should the priorities of the police be? How many police should there be? You might say we should have as many police as possible. Okay, but every police officer is somebody who's taken away from some other productive employment. So we have to use the feedback of the market to sort all this out. But there is no such feedback. And so what we've seen instead is that the government makes its own priorities for what the police should do. Not what the people want, but what the government wants. And the result has been what an old writer acquaintance of mine used to call anarcho-tyranny. Now, he meant it in a different sense, but I love that term, anarcho-tyranny. It's anarcho in the sense that the things you might theoretically want police officers to do, police departments all over the country do terrible jobs at. If you were to find out the percentage of murderers or burglars who are actually caught, found guilty, legitimately found guilty, and punished, you would be shocked at how low it is. You wouldn't even be sitting here. You'd be out stocking up on weapons if you knew how low it is. And, of course, they don't want you to know how low it is, but it's low. It's low. Single-digit percent, maybe? Very low. On the other hand, one thing they are great at is shows of force and intimidating the public. That they're excellent at. They're excellent at going after people who have never done any physical harm to anyone, but ingest a substance that the state doesn't want them to ingest. They are excellent at that. In fact, they're so excellent at it that the United States has a greater prison population than any country in the world. And I don't mean per capita or on a percentage basis, as you might think. I'm talking absolute numbers, providing civilized life. Well, they're not so good at that, but destroying things, ruining people's lives, that's what they specialize in, the state. And so what we have is a narco-tyranny. They don't protect you against threats to your life and property, but they do make sure that peaceful people who were never going to hurt you are stuck in cages being raped, because that's the most humane solution to somebody's drug problem. When they get extra money for doing this by means of asset forfeiture laws, well, the choice is pretty easy. Am I going to investigate your home break-in? I don't think so. I still remember an incident when I was in graduate school. I was at Columbia University, and I'd never really lived in that sort of a city before. And a friend of mine from Connecticut came to visit. While we were having dinner, his car was broken into, and some items were stolen. And it so happened that a police car was driving by, so we flagged him down, and we said, look, my car was just broken into, and he told us that was a real shame and drove away. When people want something, the market will supply it to them. That is the law that government is fighting its best against. People will get what they want one way or another. And then finally, there are vested interests at stake in the police militarization and in the drug war. And this is why I think it's so disillusioning for young people. They say to themselves, look, I was the captain of the high school debate team, so I can make a really good argument against the war on drugs. So if I just make that argument, the war on drugs will just melt away. It doesn't matter what your arguments are. People's livelihoods are at stake here. You can take your arguments and stick them. Doesn't matter. There are vested interests at stake, economic interests. Two investigative journalists summarized the situation this way. Many police, including beat cops, now routinely carry assault rifles. Combined with body armor and other apparel, many officers look more and more like combat troops serving in Iraq and Afghanistan. Paul Craig Roberts, who served in the Reagan administration, reports today 17,000 local police forces are equipped with such military equipment as Black Hawk helicopters, machine guns, grenade launchers, battering rams, explosives, chemical sprays, body armor, night vision, and armored vehicles. As John Whitehead puts it, what began with the militarization of the police in the 1980s during the government's war on drugs has snowballed into a full-fledged integration of military weaponry, technology, and tactics into police protocol. For example, in 1981, Congress passed the Military Cooperation with Law Enforcement Act, which granted the military the power to help local police forces wage the war on drugs by sharing equipment, training, and intelligence. In 1997, Congress approved the 1033 program, which allows the Secretary of Defense to transfer surplus military supplies and weapons to local law enforcement agencies without charge. They just have to pay shipping. There's no Amazon Prime for this. They're getting assault rifles, mini tanks, grenade launchers, and my personal favorite, remote-controlled robots. In Oxford, Alabama, the 50-person police force there now has $3 million worth of equipment, M16s, infrared goggles, and an armored vehicle. In Des Moines, the police have two $180,000 bomb robots. In Montgomery County, Texas, the sheriff's department owns a $300,000 surveillance drone. In Cobb County, Georgia, the police have an amphibious tank. In Richland County, South Carolina, the police have a machine gun-equipped armored personnel carrier called the Peacemaker. This type of equipment had previously been seen only in war zones. Some of you may follow the Free State Project in New Hampshire. These are people who believe in the non-aggression principle, don't initiate physical force against anybody else, but apparently believing in not initiating physical force is one of the most dangerous threats New Hampshire has ever faced. And so there was a police department that got hold of a bearcat. They applied for it, and they got it approved. And they said, we are under threat here, domestic threat, because we've got the Occupy movement and we've got the Free State Project. Here's what the bearcat is. It's a 16,000-pound bulletproof truck with battering rams, gun ports, tear gas dispensers, and radiation detectors. Costs almost $250,000, and it's been sold to over 500 local agencies. In 1980, there were fewer than 3,000 reported SWAT raids. And now the number is believed to be over 50,000. Three-quarters of these are drug raids, and most of these are low-level drug raids. By the late 1980s, nearly every city with at least 100,000 people now had a SWAT team or was on the way to getting one. There was, at one time, something called the Law Enforcement Assistance Administration at the federal level, and it handed out money and equipment to police departments, and the director was a guy named Don Santarelli. He recalls, this is already in the early 70s, he's already recalling this. He says, talking about local police departments, they didn't value education or training. They valued hardware, whether it was armored personnel carriers, tanks, whatever they were asking for. Los Angeles wanted a submarine. He said anything the police chiefs could dream up to make themselves look more fearsome, they wanted. I like these statistics, too, by the way, to show how delusional people were on this subject of the war on drugs. You know, I'm super square. I've got four kids with a fifth on the way. I drive a minivan. I have never ingested any illegal substance in my life. I am as dull and boring as can be. But I believe in the great principle of mind your own business. I'm not going to use marijuana, but I don't want to be lied to about it. I don't want that second grade film strip that we got where they're shown, here's the guy the first day he uses it, and he looks like pretty much a normal person. There, here he is on the 17th day, and he's like, you know, like an old crone, you know, with a cane, and, you know, and here are his lungs, and it's just like somebody took a black crayon, and, you know, there are health issues related to marijuana, but for heaven's sake, right? Nobody's overdosing on it. Nobody, I mean, really. So I don't like that. And in particular, it seems like because this war on drugs has penetrated into the American consciousness so much as something we must declare victory in. Now, it's breaking down a little bit, but there are a lot of people who wouldn't even consider having a different thought on this, that they're willing to believe anything about it. So in 1972, Richard Nixon claimed that every year heroin addicts were stealing the equivalent of $2 billion worth of property. George McGovern even said they were stealing $4.4 billion worth of property every year to get their fix. Charles Percy, an Illinois senator, said they were stealing between $10 and $15 billion worth of property every year. Turns out the total value of all reported stolen property by everybody, heroin addict or not, in the United States in 1972, $1.2 billion. Everybody. According to Nixon, every year, heroin addicts were engaging in 365 million burglaries. You want to know the total number of burglaries committed by heroin people and non-heroin people put together in 1971 in the U.S.? 1.8 million. And yet, I mean, did anybody call him on this? Like, that's a preposterous fate. No, people just accept it. Well, look, the government has identified a danger. And why? What possible interest would the government have in exaggerating a danger? I don't see it. We had this federal campaign against marijuana production in the early 1980s. This was going to bring in the National Guard to search out and destroy Northern California marijuana fields. Summer 1983, the federal government sent U-2 spy planes over California. That was the thing that scuttled the summit between Eisenhower and Khrushchev? Because they were flying them over the Soviet Union and pretending they weren't? Now they're just openly doing it here. And then the asset forfeiture laws kicked in, and this allowed the local law enforcement to keep most of the assets they seized if they were drug-related. Now, supposedly, they've got safeguards in place, but they really don't. In 1985, a DEA agent writing in his book Cash Crop very frankly said, the biggest focus of what we're doing is going to be on land seizures. Anybody who's growing marijuana on their land, we're going to take their land. It's as simple as that. It's done civilly through the federal system. Basically, people have to prove that they weren't involved and didn't know about it. Oh, that should be a breeze. I'll prove to you that I didn't know about it. Yeah, see, a lot of normal people would think that's a bad thing, the whole reversal of the burden of proof. But no, this was just openly stated. That's right. It is a reversal of the burden of proof. So it turns out that these dangerous, terrible drug kingpins aren't so dangerous after all, because the rule was that if you hand over your land, we'll let you go free, even though you're a menace to society. What we really want is the stuff. What are the incentives that follow from this? Well, what types of crimes are they more likely to go after? Are they as concerned about the burglary of your house as they would otherwise be? Another incentive is wait until the drugs are sold and then go after the drug dealers. Now, supposedly, they want to keep us safe from the drug dealers and from the drugs getting out into society. So you'd think they'd want to stop the drug dealers before they can sell the drugs. But it's much more common they want to wait until the drugs have become cash. Then we'll get them. Ah, but I thought this was all about protecting me from drugs. But they wait for the transaction to be consummated, and then they grab the cash. So you've got a major metropolitan area. You've got roads with lanes coming in and out. Car coming into that metropolitan area is full of drugs to sell in the metropolitan area. The car coming out is going to be full of cash. Guess which lanes they're more likely to stop the cars in. But they're just trying to keep us safe, right? They're just trying to keep us safe. And you get people like me who are ingrates who come along and raise these objections.